Hello, this is Code & Solder, and today I'll be reviewing the PCB manufacturer PCBWay. But first, a small disclaimer. So let's start by looking at the cost and ease of use. First of all, a two-layer board costs $10 regardless of the options marked in green. Similarly, a four-layer board with any of those options costs $47. Anything outside of those specifications increases the cost drastically. The calculator can be found at this address. As for shipping, they offer DA gel for $25 for 1 kg and $36 for 2 kg, with a delivery time of around 3 days and around 40% cheaper but much slower HK post. In my case, the time between placing the order and getting the package was a bit over 5 days. The ordering procedure is really simple. You start by logging in, then you click on PCB Instant Quote and fill in all the required details. And finally, you click on Add to Cart and upload your Gerber files. And now you are ready to order. For exporting the Gerber files, the method shown in my previous video works perfectly. Click on the screen to watch it. Now let's talk about their capabilities. While PCBWay has a PCB capabilities page, it is severely outdated. Even the amount of layers offered is incorrect. A much better source is the price calculator. As we can see, the maximum size in any direction is 1200 mm. There doesn't seem to be a limit on the number of pieces. They offer boards with up to 14 layers. Buried vias are possible for an extra fee. They also produce boards on aluminium substrate, although with only one layer. The offered board thicknesses range from 0.4 to 2.4 mm. For an extra price, the track width and distance can go down to 5x5 mm, and the hole size to 0.2 mm. All 6 solder mask colors are included in the price. The Silkscreen color is locked to the solder mask. 5 different types of surface finishes are offered at different prices. The vias can be tenting, plugged or not covered. And they offer copper thicknesses of up to 4 ounces. Their warranty policy is really reasonable, including free replacement boards. As they said in their policy, the customer is responsible for any taxes in their country, which has actually happened to me during this order. They also offer numerous sponsorship programs, such as free boards for students and competitions, and cheaper assembly for educational purposes. There also exist many opportunities to get discount coupons, such as sharing your purchase experience. Speaking of which, if you want to support this channel, please use this link when registering. They also offer free small universal boards and paid bigger ones, although it's cheaper to buy your own design than to purchase those. Now that we're done with the theoretical part, let's start by unboxing the boards I got. They come packaged in this DA gel foil, weighing around 1.2 kg or 2.6 pounds. After cutting the foil, we discover a PCBWay branded box closed with tape. Inside of it, there is some packaging material, 2-3 sets of prototype boards, the open theremin board I ordered, first set of boards for a giveaway I'm running, the boards for my oven controller, and the second set of boards for the giveaway. Each set of the boards is covered in protective shrink wrap, including a layer of bubble foil at the bottom, in my opinion protecting them sufficiently. After unboxing the boards, I removed the solder mask from them. After doing so, I scanned both sides of the boards, with and without solder mask, at 1200 dpi. This resolution gives me about 1.2 pixels per mil, which is more than enough for this analysis. The green foam is used to create contrast between the whole plating and the background. After that was done, I did some cleaning up in GIMP. I straightened the images and cropped them to their desired sizes. At first, there seemed to be an offset between the pads and the rest of the copper. But after reversing the boards in the scanner, it turned out just to be a problem with the sensor. I opened the Gerber files in GERBV a free open source Gerber viewer, and then exported them to PNG at 1200 dpi, just like the scans. After that, I imported both scans with and without Soldermask into GIMP, and then layered them with the Gerber file I rendered. I used copper and the holes to match them up. I had to reduce the working area because the scale seemed to be a bit shifted. Now that we're done with preparing the files, we can start comparing them. First, let's start with copper. It seems to match really closely to the Gerber files, in most places being a bit thicker, though it does not impact the overall usability of the boards. The difference seems to be less than a couple mil, and with the 6 mil minimum supported distance, it should not be a problem. Interestingly enough, this problem does not occur on the bottom layer, where the distance between the ground plane and the traces is 5 mil. They also didn't make any problems about this. There isn't a lot to say about the solder mask. It is very uniform, but it is offset from the copper by around 3 mil from its desired location. The thinnest strip of it I could find was about 7 mil, and it was correct. Now, as to the silkscreen, the resolution is quite good, with digits as small as 1 mm being readable. From the images, the resolution seems to be about 600 dpi. It is, though, offset by around 5 to 7 mil from its desired location. I haven't found any unexposed copper, though. Now for the comparison, I aligned the files by silkscreen. As we can see here, the silkscreen, while slightly offset and a bit thicker than the Gerber files, is still quite good. The drilling quality is quite good and the holes are consistent. I didn't have any problems with them, they are well centered and have correct distances from each other. The plating is also quite flat, the holes that should be plated have a really nice finish, and the ones that shouldn't be aren't. While all of my boards were usable, they didn't really push any design limits. In his recent post by Andy Brown, we can read that he had some problems with solder mask, especially around the BGA footprints. Still, it only affected a few of his boards, and most of them were usable in the end. I highly recommend this post, as it contains many interesting insights into designing boards for parts with high pin count. I soldered one of my boards, and all of the components on it, ranging from 1206 capacitors to big 2.5 mm copper wire used to reinforce tracks, soldered perfectly, although the wire took a significant amount of time due to its thermal mass. My final opinion is that the boards are good enough for pretty much all hobby purposes. They are made fast and for a reasonable price. I'm sure I will order again. Please leave a like if you liked this video, a dislike if you disliked it, subscribe if you want to see more like it, and tell me in the comments what would you like to see next.